Good Samaritan Hospital, downtown LA. But when I was 4 and a half, almost 5, my parents moved to Fullerton, California. Used to be an orange grove, plowed down orange trees, made a little neighborhood. The reason they picked this neighborhood was that from my house, I could walk to my elementary school, I could walk to my junior high school, and I could walk to my high school. They thought, what's better than that? So I walked to school, and I have this memory that came up when I read this reading and studied it this week, that I was walking to high school. I remember because that was the direction I was going. I don't know what grade I was in, but I was in high school. And as I walked along, I had my usual self-conscious thoughts. I was angular and awkward. I was very self-focused because I was so terribly shy that I just was very conscious of every little burp that I made or trip that I made. And I was just very anxious. Anyway, I was walking to school, absorbed in my anxious thoughts, when all of a sudden I heard the birds singing. And I stopped thinking. And then I smelled the orange blossoms, because not all of them had been plowed down yet. And I could smell the orange blossoms, feel the sun on my face, hear the birds, and it was as if Jesus were calling my name. There was a language that went direct from God to me, and I recognized it when I heard it. I thought, what a gorgeous world this is. How lucky I am to be in this world, and how lucky I am to be me, recognizing that this is all God's. I didn't yet have a relationship with Jesus or know how Jesus fitted into this, but that didn't matter. I knew what language God spoke. And I felt that later on when I was in church, and it was the same language. So my story continued, but that's my first memory of knowing that I have a part in God's plan, and that it was speaking to me, God was speaking to me. So we have always, on the fourth Sunday after Easter, it's always Good Shepherd Sunday. Y'all knew that, right? So we have 3 years in our lectionary. We get 3 different readings, all from the 10th chapter of John's Gospel. The reading this year is year A, so you will notice that we stop just short of Jesus saying, I am the Good Shepherd. He doesn't say it in today's text. He says, I am the gate. Ooh, very transformational. I am the gate. So we actually have to go through him to get into the enclosure, the sheepfold. And the beginning of this verse talks about how Jesus calls us out of the sheepfold. So he indirectly says he is the Good Shepherd. And he mentions God as the gatekeeper. God the gatekeeper opens the gate. Jesus walks out, he's our shepherd, calls us to follow, and what do? We follow him, right? Golly, we follow him. He is our shepherd. So far, so good, right? What we need to do, and we've done this in Bible study, especially on our Wednesday class, because we're learning how to read these gospel lessons, read what comes right before this, because this Good Shepherd story is a direct reflection on the story of the man who was born blind, who Jesus gets that mud and spreads it all over his eyes and tells him to go down to the pool of Siloam, which means sent, wash in the pool, and come back. Remember that story? When he comes back, he knows that the man named Jesus healed him, but he was blind, so he didn't see him, right? And when he comes back, Jesus is hiding anyway, and he doesn't know who he is in the first place. What happens to this man is why we get the Good Shepherd parable, which is such a beautiful metaphor for our faith and so many people's favorites. I know people who love this Good Shepherd. The reason we have it is because of this blind man. Because what happened to this blind man is he became center of this controversy, because everybody refused to see that Jesus did this miracle. They had things in the way. These are the bandits and the thieves that are trying to steal us away from Jesus. These are the bandits and thieves. One of them is the Pharisees. They say, well, this can't be the miracle that we think it is, because this is the Sabbath. And this man cannot be from God, meaning Jesus, because he would not heal on the Sabbath. If he knew this is the Sabbath, he would not be doing a healing, so that can't be the miracle. Yeah, follow that. And then his parents abandon him. They say, yes, that man, we gave birth, I gave birth to a man that was blind. You'll have to ask that man how he was healed. I have no idea. So this is mom and his dad. So they abandon him. And then everybody standing around says, is this the man? And he's saying, yes, I'm the man. No, maybe this is somebody else who looks a lot like him, but he couldn't be actually seen because that doesn't happen. Nobody born blind is healed. So nobody in this crowd believes that God healed him. Only him. This is the part of the 23rd Psalm where it says, you prepare a table in the midst of my enemies. The only person being fed here by Jesus is the man born blind. He has been healed. He knows who healed him. He can't see him because he was blind when he was healed. He needs a little help from Jesus. So Jesus, the good shepherd, what does he do? He goes in there and stands in front of him and he says, do you know who healed you? And he said, a man called Jesus. That's all I know. And he said, I am he, the one who is looking at you. And the man falls on his face and he worships Jesus. And then comes this story of who is your good shepherd. And being able to eat this meal prepared for us, just us, is having our own personal Jesus, preparing something that's just for us in the midst of our enemies. So our enemies aren't saying ridiculous things about us not being healed when we are healed, but they don't often believe the faith that we carry around our enemies. We don't think of them as enemies, but our culture is not Christian. In case anybody hadn't guessed that yet, our culture is not Christian, but we are Christian. And we are called to a higher standard and to a more intimate relationship with the God who calls us by name. And when we own that, we feel like we can conquer anything, right? Jesus will feed us that meal that we need in the midst of our enemies. And we will listen for his name. So in order to hear what God has to say to us, we have to kind of do our calisthenics. We have to come regularly to church, and we have to say our prayers, and we have to ask God for help. So I taught the kids today three basic prayers. And I'm sure you all do these all the time, but not everybody's thinking they're praying when they do it. First prayer, help. Second prayer, thanks. You've read Anne Lamott, my favorite author. Third prayer, wow. Help. Thanks. Wow. If you know when you're saying help, thanks, wow, that you're talking to God, you're praying. And that connects you even further. So be aware of when you say help, thanks, wow, and know where it comes from. And know who it's leading you to and who is calling you by name. Now my story went very many directions. Little did I know I would move to Georgia and New York State in order to follow this God who keeps talking to me. But that's what God does. Prepares a meal for you in the midst of your foreigners, enemies, distractions, you fill in the blank. Buckle your seatbelt.